The metacarpals is a group of five bones in the hand that lies between the phalanges of the fingers and the carpal bones of the wrist. They form the intermediate part of the hand that forms the connection to the forearm. The metacarpal bones are small, yet they are classified as long bones, the reason being they have the structural characteristics of the long bones. The top of the metacarpals form the knuckles. Connective tissue is covering them on the palmar surface. You can feel and see the metacarpals on the backside of your hand through your skin. Like, I can palpate my metacarpals very easily. The metacarpal bones are corresponding to the metatarsal bones in the foot. Now, the metacarpal bones forms the carpo-metacarpal joint, where they are connected to the carpal bones of the wrist proximally and forms metacarpophalangeal joint when they combine with phalanges of the fingers distally. The MTP is commonly referred to as knuckle joint. If we change the view, we see a transverse arch that is formed by the metacarpal bones to which the rigid row of distal carpal bones are fixed. Now, if we talk about the peripheral metacarpals, which are the thumb and the little finger, they both form the cup-shaped palmar gutter, which is deeper in the center, forming the concavity. The most firmly fixed metacarpal in the hand is the index metacarpal. The thumb metacarpal articulates with the trapezium. The middle metacarpal articulates with the carpal bones by the innate interlocking bone elements at the bases. The ring metacarpal is somewhat more mobile, whereas the fifth metacarpal is semi-independent. Now we will discuss the individual metacarpal bones in the next section, so stick with me. Looking individually to a metacarpal bone, it will be consisting of a body or shaft and two extremities, the head and the base. The head is located at the distal end, which is near to the fingers, and the base is directed at the proximal, or we can say the carpal end, which is facing the wrist joint. The medial and lateral surfaces of the metacarpal bones are concave. They allow the attachment site for the intrauscii muscles. Now, head has many names. We can call it caput or the digital extremity. It has an oval surface which is remarkably convex from behind to front and flat from side to side. The head articulates with the proximal phalanx. It is broader and extends farther upward on the volar aspect. It is longer in the anterior-posterior diameter. On either side of the head, there is a tubercle for the attachment of collateral ligament of the metacarpophalangeal joint. Moving to the dorsal surface, it is broad and flat, which supports the tendons of the extensor muscles. The neck is also called as subcapital segment because it is located below the caput or the head. We can find the nutrien foramen quite oftenly in the neck region, towards the medial surface of the first and second metacarpal to the lateral surface of the remaining metacarpals. Then comes the body or the shaft of the metacarpal bone. It is prismoid and curved in shape, such as it is convex posteriorly and concave anteriorly. The body has three surfaces, that is medial, lateral and dorsal. And it has two borders, the ulnar border and the radial border. Looking at the medial and lateral surfaces, they are concave and separated from one another by a prominent anterior ridge. In the distal two-third of the dorsal surface, there is a smooth, triangular, flattened area which is covered by the tendons of extensor muscles. Coming to borders, the ulnar border is named as it is towards the direction of the ulnar bone, and radial border is in reference to the radial bone. Then comes the base of the metacarpals. The base or the carpal extremity is of the cuboidal form. It is broader from back and articulates with the carpal and the adjoining metacarpal bones. Its dorsal and volar surfaces are rough, providing the attachment of ligaments. If we look at the middle metacarpal, so it has a styloid process which is directed in the dorsal side into an angle which is located between the capitate and the trapezoid bone. So this is all about the anatomical landmarks of the metacarpal bones. Let's move ahead to get to know more. So the first metacarpal bone is the most lateral one. It is one of the thickest and smallest among the five metacarpals. Its long axis is medially rotated for the 90 degrees. A longitudinal ridge is present on its medial or palmar surface. And because of this ridge, the medial surface is divided into a large lateral and a small medial part. If we talk about the head of this bone, it is flattened as compared to the other metacarpals. Its base has a saddle-shaped articular surface. Because of this surface, the first metacarpal articulates with the trapezium bone. The salient feature of second metacarpal is it has the largest base among all with the longest shaft. The base has several areas for the articulation with the carpal bones. We have a groove in the coronal plane with the help of which it articulates with the trapezoid bone. If we move medial to this groove, there is a ridge for the articulation with the capitate bone. Then heading laterally, we can find a quadrangular surface for the joint with the trapezium bone. The second metacarpal articulates with the third metacarpal at the base. Moving on to the third metacarpal bone, it is located at the base of middle finger. The distinguishing feature of this bone is it has a styloid process that projects proximally from the lateral dorsal edge of its base that provide articulation with the capitate bone. There are four surfaces of the base. The lateral surface articulates with the second metacarpal and the medial surface articulates with the fourth metacarpal with the help of two oval articular surfaces. The palmar surface of the base provides insertion to the flexor carpi radialis muscle, whereas the extensor carpi radialis brevis inserts to its dorsal surface. The shaft is similar to that of the second metacarpal bone. Now coming to the ring finger metacarpal, some important specifications of the base of this metacarpal bone are two oval facets that can be found on the lateral surface through which it articulates with the base of third metacarpal. Along with that, there is an articulation point for capitate as well. A single elongated facet present on its medial surface that provide articulation with the base of fifth metacarpal. The proximal surface is quadrangular in shape that provides articulation with the hamate bone. Now the little or the fifth metacarpal bone. It is one of the smallest of all five metacarpals. Its base is slightly different from the other metacarpals. The reason because its lateral part is non-articular and the lateral side of the base articulates with the hamate bone. Talking about the proximal and distal part of the lateral surface of the shaft of the fifth metacarpal bone, we can find out that the proximal part articulates with the fourth metacarpal and the distal part receives the fibers from the four distal and four palmar intraosseous muscle. We know that on the proximal end, the metacarpals articulates with the distal row of the carpal bones. And on the distal end, each metacarpal head articulates with the base of its corresponding proximal phalanx. First is the thumb metacarpal, which articulates with the trapezium through a saddle-shaped synovial joint. The second is the index metacarpal that articulates with the trapezoid as well as trapezium through a small tubercle. The third or the middle metacarpal articulates with the capitate bone. The fourth or the ring metacarpal articulates with the hamate as well as the small part of the capitate. The last one is the little metacarpal, which articulates with the hamate bone. The four metacarpals other than the thumb metacarpals are also joined proximally with each other. The ligaments of the intermetacarpal articulations are present, which unite the metacarpal bones. These are the dorsal, introsseous, and palmar metacarpal ligaments. We have done all the articulations of the metacarpal bones. Let's move ahead. Let's talk about the muscle attachment now, as we all know they are very important for the movements of the hand. So first of all, we will talk about the opponent pollicis muscle, which inserts into the radial border of the thumb metacarpal. The next one is the adductor pollicis muscle. It has two heads. So the transversus head of the adductor pollicis arises from the ridge present alongside the palmar surface of the shaft of middle metacarpal. And the oblique head of the adductor pollicis arises from the bases of the index and middle metacarpals. The opponens digiti minimi muscle. It is inserting into the palmar surface of the fifth metacarpal with the ulnar border of shaft. Moving to the introsseae muscles, the palmar introsseae arise from the flexor surfaces of the shaft of metacarpal directed from the groove that faces towards the middle metacarpal. Ischiometacarpal ligament joins the pisiform bone to the base of fifth metacarpal. The tendon of flexor carpi radialis muscle inserts into the base of second and third metacarpal bone. Abductor pollicis longest muscle on the base of fifth metacarpal helps in the abduction of thumb. And the dorsal introsseae arises from the longitudinal grooves present on the flexor surfaces of the metacarpal shaft that extends around to the dorsal surface. Extensor carpi radialis longus inserts in the base of second metacarpal and controls the wrist movement. Extensor carpi radialis brevis extend and abduct the wrist. It is found on the base of the posterior aspect of third metacarpal. Extensor carpi ulnaris inserts to the medial aspect of base of fifth metacarpal bone. Do you know you can sometimes find the sesamoid bones at the metacarpal heads, especially at the second and the fifth, within the palmar capsule of the metacarpophalangeal joints? The metacarpals in many mammals have undergone many changes and reduction during the process of evolution. For example, the lower leg of the horse includes only one strengthened metacarpal. The two splint bones behind and above the hoof and metacarpals are reduced and the remaining two original metacarpals have been lost. In both birds and bats, part of wings is formed by metacarpals. The neck of the metacarpal is a common location for the Boxer's fracture, hence termed Boxer fracture. Benetti fracture is the most common fracture involving the base of the thumb. It is an intra-articular fracture which is separating the palmar aspect of the first metacarpal base from the remaining first metacarpal bone. This was all about our not-so-famous metacarpal bones. I hope you have understood their anatomy, articulations and attachments in detail. To get your mind enriched with medical knowledge, keep watching Scalia.com. It's fuel for your thoughts.